Y esta es la hora que yo no he terminado de digerir el capítulo 58 del libro de Isaías, que vendría a ser la visión que Dios a mí me dio. Y cada vez que leo un poco más, me doy cuenta de lo que Dios me está diciendo ahí. Aquella fue una orden y han pasado 16 años.
Probando.
One, two, uno, dos. Testing. Testing, testing. Testing, testing. Testing, testing. Testing.
Se deleita en la cercanía de Dios. Es decir,
Testing.
Test. One, two. You hear that?
One of those. Caleb, can you hear me? One, two. One of those. It's good, okay. So, he's saying that the purpose that he came was to praise God and not to visit. And that when he came, he had a fever, and he thinks he made the whole airplane sick. And I'm not here against my will, because I believe that this life is a blessing. I want to explain a little bit. One of the things that are terrible from religion is that it becomes something that you have to do, and it stops being something that is delightful to do. What if I said, if you don't come to this event, you lose the coverage? Maybe it's necessary, but it's sad. Because because I think that everybody should be here because with the light, because that's what they want. What was it that made Brother Julio come all this way? What was it that made people that came from far away, why are they here? It has to be delightful. It has to be a pleasure. Evangelism, if this life doesn't become something delightful for us, then we're in serious problems. You can't hear it. 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, uno, dos. 1, 2, test. 1, 2, 1, 2, test. Okay. The volume is also on that corner. The little, yeah. What I focus on is on this. And if there's something else that I focus more, I want you to get rid of it. And maybe that's just the way I was brought up. Maybe that's the way he made me. I think what I really liked was that. And the bad things, that was something that was bad for me. For example, I'd like to play pool. And I skipped school to go play. There was like a huge walls that I had to climb, and I dropped. I fell from the other side, and I went to play the whole day. And I was there before they opened the pool place. And I hit all the pool sticks. And I was there all day with the exams. Hey, it's not working? Okay. 1, 2, 1, 2. Test. You hear it? 1, 2, 1, 2. Test. That's good? Better? Okay. And now that I think about how long I play pool, it's just a waste of time, a waste of life. And that's also how much I like to drink alcohol. I had to like finish all of the alcohol of the world just to save everybody else. And God freed me from that. But when he freed me with the same impetus in which I was looking for that other stuff, I dove headfirst into this walk. And all my family was Christian, and they all talked to me about God. And now they're all my sheep. My mom was the one that insisted the most, "Son, please." And she did a whole bunch of traps, and I walked away and away. And when I became it became my vice. And I don't want to live without it. And I can't live without it. So my mom was in heaven already. She became a sheep, and every once in a while she would say, "Son, don't stay too long at church." I would say, "Hey, if you don't behave, I'm gonna discipline you as your pastor." And I fell in love And that was my advice. Also, with my wife, I was in love. I have 4 years of being with her, and I'm not bored. And we go together at church, and I stay in my office, and about half an hour, I call the secretary, and I was like, where's my wife? I have a problem in my life. I'm too dependent. But now I became dependent of God. I can't live without Him. I don't find meaning to life. Just imagine a moment in which I couldn't live for Him, to talk to Him, or to have access to the Word. I would say that would be something terrible for me. Awful. I can't live without Him. So when people that wrote the Psalms, and I understand them a little bit, when they say, who do I have in heavens but you? What can I do? What else do I have? I prefer a day in your altar than 1,000 away from them. And I one day that I was thinking about this, 1,000 in 320, what's the ratio? Imagine if somebody had cancer, and if somebody said, so the ratio comes up to 3, the division comes up to 3. So, anyway, let's keep going with the story. So somebody has cancer, and the doctor says, you don't have so long to live, and the person says, I'm willing to eat spiders or tarantulas, whatever it may take. Whatever you give me. And why do they do it? Because they want to prolong their life. And there's options, chemo. And he says, if we do all that, you can live about 6 more months. And anybody would say, please do it, because I want to live 6 more months. But what the psalmist says in Psalms, he says, I prefer one day in your altar than 3 years away from them. If somebody gave me the option to live in your altar, not even in the holy place. And on the other hand, 3 years away from your altar, I prefer your altar. And I give you back all 3 years, but I want a day with you, Lord. So, sons, and I love them with all my heart. Some of them I see them close to God, others I see them close to the church because of me, because my church is so big and I'm there from 6 in the morning on Sunday. I leave at 10 at night. Some of them, they leave me a message. It says, Dad, I came at 3. You preach of this, and I had to go because I had to do this. Hugs. Serve saying, I was here. And I could force them. I want you here. Or you're gonna know who Sergio Enriquez is. But what do I get from forcing them? You know what I do? I'm gonna go pray to God. And I tell him I want that this sons fell in love with you. And that they come not because I asked them or that I twist their arm or grab them from the ear and tell them that whenever I say amen, you say amen, or you see what happens at home. Because if it's against your will, in my own verse that I wrote, I say, against your will, not even food is good. And I ask the Lord to fall in love with God. And then we're all in the same, we're on the same well, we all have the same tune, we all have the same, even though we have different cultures or ages, if we have that in common, we have a sacred link. So I understood that the mission that God gave me was take pleasure. And those who want to take pleasure, let them take pleasure. And those who don't, what can I do? Nothing. Although I know that this is good. So God in his mercy, he showed me one of the ways in which one you can exchange pleasures. So when I take pleasure in him, I notice that the king also likes to take pleasure. And I would imagine that when he finds someone who takes pleasure, he will want to be with him. He must say, this takes pleasure in me. I want to be with him because they have the same tune. And how do we do so that he takes pleasure? So, I don't know if you know that there are some people that you want to be with. And in my regular life, about 40 years ago, in my job, I was a traveler, and I went around the country, and we were working hard. And at night, we gather in the hotels, only for travelers. It's a traveler's hotel. Maybe one or two doctors, but it was mostly travelers, and we were all friends. And we ate. That's where we ate. That's where the lady that cooked would always make us food, and there was always chicken, beef, and eggs. And I want beef, and we would all order. And there was a whole dining room for us, but there are certain things where there was a friend of ours whose name was Olmedo was, he would arrive, and it doesn't matter if it was a bad day, he would always come singing and telling stories, and he was very alive. And when we knew that he was traveling, we were happy, and we would ask him, where are you going to stay tomorrow, Olmedo? And he says, okay, I'll see you there. Because really, we wanted to be with him. it was pleasurable to be with them. But there was a doctor who we nicknamed her Mother Pain, Mama Pain. And you know why we call her that? Do you remember the telenovela that is called the the Rite of Birth? And there was a story, and she was from Cuba, and we call her Mama Pain, not because she was Cuban, but she was always complaining. She would come with the doctors to complain. She would say, I don't have money, I don't have a medicine, I don't have... Nobody wanted to be with her. And there's a lot of questions like that are Mama Pain's. They come to church and they don't praise the Lord, but they complain to the Lord. Complaining, while the Bible says, ask the Lord with cry outs, but with actions of thanks, thankful actions. I give you thanks because I'm alive. A little bit crooked, but I'm alive. Because there's people that didn't even woke up today, and we woke up. That's enough reason to give thanks to the Lord. Give a hand to the Lord. So, if I can control what he takes pleasures on, then we're set. I'm set, because that's what I'm always going to give him. So I found a verse in Genesis 49:20. It says, the bread of Asher. That was the son of Jacob. Said, it will be thick. And he will give pleasure to the king. So, this was his genetic, because in this verse we can see all the genetic of all of the sons of Jacob. But when you hear first this one of his talents is that he would give pleasure to the king. That was his talent. So, I want to be like him. I want to give pleasure to the king. Because if I don't, because if I do, he's going to take pleasure in he's going to take pleasure in me. So it becomes a circle, continuous circle, where my life's going to be delightful. Who wants a delightful life? Sometimes I hear people who complain a lot, even from the altar. Life is hard. This walk, the work, and I just observe. And I say, maybe, because everybody talks the way their walk has been, and with all due respect, I see in my own life, I remember that verse that says, my load is easy and light, and now that's my life, and I see that everything has gone well. God gave me a wonderful, beautiful life that loves me and stays covered by me. That's a lot that a woman that a wife is willing to be covered by you. That's hard to find. That's a blessing. No, really, that's a blessing. Because there was an elder that came to my church, a man of God, and I have about 30-something years. And he's an elder. And he came and said, "Brother Apostle, I want to tell you that the process is over." And I asked him, "How is it?" And he said, "I am free." You know what he was talking about? About his wife. About 7 years ago, there was a demon that came in her, just like you hear it. And she would chuck her stuff from the window. And he had to call somebody else to go pick him up. And when she saw another elder, and she started screaming and insulting. And she was a fine person, but very rude. About 6-7 years without seeing his sons, and he was accused falsely, and he almost went to jail until the Lord helped him and he came free. And I said, "Thank you for the wife that you gave me." Thank you, because I didn't marry Isabel. It's not Delilah, not Natalia, not Leith, not all those women, bad women from the Bible. The one who finds a wife finds the blessing of God. Those who are married, I don't want to pressure you, but how many of you have found that blessing? As the favor of Jehovah. Amen. Let's clap. So first my wife, and then my sons. I was looking at some pictures, and sometimes I feel so guilty, and I ask for forgiveness. But the church that God has gave me to pastor, it's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. My church. I even made a poem that says that the herd that you gave me to pastor has gave me a fountain. I know I have to take care of them, but I feel taken care of by your people. And it became true life for that verse that says that their sons became warriors. And if you're attacked, you won't fear, because they will be with you at the door ready. And I kept on thinking, and I did that, thinking of the people that God gave me. They're a blessing, and I love them. The pastors that God gave me, they're a blessing, this man of God. I'm not going to say anything, because there's a few that are not under my coverage, so I don't want to make them feel bad. But it's a blessing. It's an extraordinary blessing. They're behind the word. They're under my coverage. They take care of the doctrine. And I am blessed. I am blessed. And then some people say life is hard. But the part that I have, I had the easy life, because maybe some people may be eating meat from the same cow, but maybe I had the better piece of meat. But I did have the better piece of meat. And if you're from that movement, you would also be part of that blessing. I don't want to be a martyr. In the sense that they're going to crucify me. They didn't give me that capacity. I bless them. And I salute them. But I would like that the king would take pleasure in me. And Jesus said, Isaiah said, if he would take pleasure in ours, it would be good. How many of you have sons? When one of your sons wants something and he's he behaves good and everything, and he's a good kid, and when he asks you something, whatever he asks, and the other son will say, well, why do you only do it to him? One of my sons, he said that, do you think I can go to this place? And I had pleasure in him. And he said, yes, you can go. And I asked him, you have money? And he said, yes, I do. And I asked him, and I told him, take some more. And he didn't want to take it. And I told him, take some more. He took pleasure. I took pleasure in him. So think about God. If you give him pleasure, imagine what he would give you. And it says that he won't even give you the things that you ask from your mouth. But the Bible says, take pleasure in Jehovah, and he will give you the petitions of your heart. You won't even have to say them. In your heart, you would be asking, I wish I had more cream. Living in Canada, I wish I had that cream that make in Guatemala, the Cisco. And then somebody calls you, hey brother. You won't even know who's talking to you. You won't even guess where I am. I'm in Winnipeg. And you won't guess what somebody sent you. It cost me, I almost went to jail in immigration, but you know what? I brought you cream from Tasisco, Guatemala. And I can't believe it. Because he took pleasure in Jehovah. The petitions from your heart. And I've seen people, even the color of a watch, that he likes watches, and I don't like them, but I have about 50 of them. Look, I'm watchless. I'm always asking the time, because I don't like them. and he likes them. And there was a watch that he saw, and it says, how much is that? And he was about to use his card. He said, no, thank you. And then they were wanting to sell that, and he said no, and he turned around, and he went to church to pastor, and one of his sheep, he said, hey, brother, can I talk to you after the church? And he was tired, and he said, hey, I went through a mall, and I saw this, and I wanted to give it to you. And you know what it was? The watch, the very same watch. Please don't misinterpret. I'm not talking about the Christianity of prosperity or anything else, but he took pleasure in God, and God gave it to him without him even asking. Take pleasure in Jehovah. So now, what's the time? 50. So let's take a look at what he likes. Five things he takes pleasure on. And it's not a coincidence that there's five. First of Chronicles 29:17. Knowing I, my God, that you try the hearts, that you weigh the hearts, and you take pleasure in their righteousness. I have offered voluntarily all these things in the integrity of my heart, and now I've seen with joy your people who are here to offer offerings, voluntary offerings to you. So, this is talking about an offering. But the person who gave it was the leader first. The person who's in front of everybody. But he gave it because it says here that he understood that the Lord took pleasure in the righteousness. You know what's the favorite dish of the Lord? Well, there's five of them. But you know what? One of them is his righteousness. How many married people are there here? What's the favorite food of your wife or husband? Tortillas with lemon and salt. I assure you that many don't know what's delightful to the other person, but they expect that they know what is delightful to you. But here's a two-way thing, a two-way street. So one of the things that he takes pleasures on that is delightful to him is righteousness. People who are not crooked, who, if they are righteous. In Guatemala, there's a building who, when they finished it, it was, nobody could live in it. Close to the center. There's a building. And they couldn't inhabit it because it was crooked, it was leaning. And they made a reference to Tower Pisa, but it was so crooked. And right now there's people living inside, and it's still crooked. But God doesn't like that. He likes that we're straight, righteous, not crooked. If you're like that, if you're like that, you are a pleasure before God. That person who found in a mall in Argentina, in Buenos Aires, a security guard, he found a suitcase full of American dollars, and everybody had left, and he found it, and he reported it, and they started looking, and people came back, and he kept it. And that could have been easily lost, but no, he had it there, and people say, why do you keep it? Why not you use it? He said, no, it's not mine. There's a whole bunch of money. But he just kept on saying, it's not mine. It doesn't belong to me. And I think he gave it back, and he didn't even, people didn't even say thank you, but he behaved righteously. So I don't know here if the banks make mistakes, but in my country they make mistakes, and maybe the teller and I wonder why they call them tellers, because tell is to tell something, but to tell, I don't know, one day I'll learn English, so a lot of times teller. And there's a brother from church says $100 more. He says, thank you, Father. I'm going to make an offering with this. How many people like righteousness? Please tell the person beside you, walk in righteousness. So there's two things here in this verse, and it's really impactful in Josiah 6:6, because I take more delight in the faithfulness than in the sacrifice, and in the knowledge of God than in the holocausts. Holocaust means sacrifice, just a bigger one. But God takes delightfulness in the faithfulness. What does it mean to be faithful? Faithfulness or loyalty. And the airline that I usually take, they would say, they would send me an email every once in a while, and they would say, we like your loyalty, and it takes me, and they send me a whole bunch of coupons, and they reward my loyalty. But I, in one way or another, and this is just an example, I am in some way I'm loyal to that airline. I don't talk bad about it, even though they would lose my baggage. If they lose it, I fight, but if I'm with them, but I don't scream to everybody. And I know they're going to give me about 10,000 miles after that. So I just keep quiet. Are you loyal? Are you loyal with your friends? Are you loyal with your church? Are you loyal to your pastor? I'm here only to give me coffee. That's not being loyal. Being loyal is tested and is legitimately parallel to the faithfulness. They go hand in hand, and God takes pleasure of those who are loyal. Loyal. One of the examples of loyalty, not so much of faithfulness, but loyalty. Hey, anybody seen that movie that's called Hutchin? It's a movie called Hachi. It's a dog. A small dog. I don't know what brand. What breed, I mean. Not brand. It was like a husky. It's a beautiful dog. Who fell in love with his owner. And he went to walk with him to the train. And it's a story of based in real life. And the guy who was a teacher at university, he had a heart attack and he didn't come back. And for 8 years, the dog came back from the time that he would come back from the train. 8 years. And the dog died there. And I tell myself, there are sheep who in 1 week the pastor is not there and they leave. They should take a class from the dogs. I mean, from church. God loves. He takes pleasure in the loyalty. And I really like that movie, that God heard the wish of my heart. And there was a brother who came, and in my house we had a rule that there was no dogs allowed. But a brother gave me a little hatchet, a little husky. He had a little sister too, but that one I'm selling. I said, give it to me. And I have both dogs, and I have them. It doesn't matter how long you travel, how much I travel. As soon as I come in, they get excited, and there's a fence, and they come closer to the fence, and I tickle them. I don't know if they do that to everybody that goes by. But how loyal are we as Christians? God loves people who are loyal to Him. Let us be loyal. Let us be loyal. Let us be righteous and loyal. Things we have to call them by their names, and we can't be traitors. The anti-loyal, the epiphany of somebody who's not loyal would be Judas Iscariot. How many people would want to be Judas? And we reject that attitude. And 62 minutes. Can I keep going? And in the knowledge of God than the Holocaust. There's people who know about everything, but they don't know God. The Bible says in Jeremiah, if one takes pride, take pride in this, that they know me, says the Lord. And Paul repeats that in the New Testament. Knowing God is one of the most wonderful things, and I'll finish here. And there was a case that my apostle would say. He says, he was telling us that in a ship, sorry, in a ship, there was a ship in the middle of the sea. It was stuck in the middle of the sea, and while they got the help, the captain made this plan to keep everybody occupied and keep their minds off the emergency. And some of them sang, some of them danced, and one of them was telling a poem. He came forward and says, "I'm gonna tell you a poem from the Bible, a psalm. Jehovah is my shepherd." And all the people were amazed. He says, "Nothing will I need." And he was a professional. And all the people, when he stopped, they were clapping. And then there was an elder. And because there was a competition, the other person almost pretty much won. And everybody thought he was just there to finish up the competition. And he said, "I came to tell you that I know the one who made this psalm." So knowing God is something beautiful. And God wants you to know him. Three things. They are pleasurable. They are delightful. There's two more. Let's keep going. Might as well. Just to read them. Sacrifice of the evildoers. It's abomination to the Lord. But the prayers of the righteous is his delightfulness. Those men and women who are righteous and they decide to go on their knees, he takes pleasure in those. To hear the words of my servant, and because of the time, I won't preach more, explain this, but there's a lot of things to explain. The uneven, the unjust balance, it's an abomination of the Lord, but the right balance is his delightfulness. And back home, if you buy peanuts, you see a huge bag and you have to take careful because they overflow. And when you eat them all, and at the end, there's something at the bottom. There's like 10 peanuts around this cylinder that's inside, and you become angry. And others who have a balance to weigh things, and with this pinky, they start to weigh it. You know, that's with the balance. And that's an example that the Lord shows. But the Lord's saying here that we be righteous, that we have principles. And I tell my brothers over there, brothers, I know that a lot of you live through bringing cars from the United States, but I tell them that you should sell them at the same price. Be because there's cars that have their stereo sound, and they have rims, chrome rims. And when they sell it, they took the wheels and they put the old ones. They took the sound system and they put an older one. And that's not right. God doesn't take pleasure in that. In no way. You have to be righteous. You have to be good. Amen. 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 This is the moment. Delightfulness. I don't know if you want to be part of the delightfulness and the Lord, and that He takes delight in you. So let's pray. Let's pray. And within that prayer, I want to bless this place. I know that it's blessed, but it's official. In the name of Jesus, let's pray.